Thank you very much. I promise you this talk will be mostly triangle inequality free. So today I'm going to be talking to you about a really kind of different approach from what people have normally taken to perform arithmetic on a quantum computer. And this is work that was developed by myself and Martin Rottler at in the Quark group at Microsoft Research. And the basic idea of what we want to do with this work is we really want to come up with a very qubit efficient way of doing arithmetic. Our goal isn't so much to try to reduce the computational time, which has really been the main goal of most of the previous work. Really what we want to be able to do is reduce the ancilla cost of doing arithmetic to as low as we possibly can. And here we focus on a particular form of arithmetic that I'll make clear later on. But the key point is we can do something really kind of amazing with this approach. What we can do is we can actually do arbitrary precision arithmetic using a constant number of qubits. The basic idea is that rather than storing the numbers that we're computing inside a qubit register that has, you know, n bits of precision, instead what we do is we store these in rotation angles of single qubits. And we use this analog degree of freedom to get around these requirements. So we're going to see some trade-offs here. And this thinking about numerical analysis and arithmetic in this perspective will lead to entirely new ways of thinking about the subject that I believe will lead to kind of new and holistic ways of thinking about how we compute on large-scale quantum computers. And all right, so now let's just begin with the kind of big picture of quantum computation for those of you who might be new to the subject. So why do we want a quantum computer? You know, or why is Microsoft interested in a quantum computer? Well, I can't fully answer that question, but I can give you a partial answer. There are some interesting things that you ought to be able to do with a quantum computer. And the first application people got really excited about was cryptography, because there's a number of crypto schemes that can be broken in polynomial time using a quantum computer, including, of course, most famously, RSA. There's also other schemes like elliptic curves that can be cracked using subsequent generalizations of the idea. Well, this is interesting, but of course, one of the big drawbacks behind the cryptography application is that there are also schemes that are known to be resistant to all known quantum attacks. They're less efficient and they're less practical than some of these, but if you want to justify building a quantum computer for that, it might be a little bit difficult. An answer that seems to be, at least at the moment, much more promising is using a quantum computer for quantum simulation. And again, the intuition behind this is really that what you'd like to do is you'd like to be able to use a quantum computer to emulate another quantum system that you can't actually construct or can't actually directly experiment with. So that way you can gain some intuition behind the model. And this, so far, again, seems to be the most promising near-term application because of the fact it offers exponential speed-ups over the best-known classical algorithms in cases, and also it solves some very important problems in chemistry and material science. Now, there are also other applications that people are exploring involving optimization and machine learning and various other things like that. So far, nobody, for these problems, typically we end up seeing polynomial rather than exponential speedups. But despite that, they can provide polynomial speedups for really important problems. So for that reason, if we were able to build a really big, really cheap quantum computer, perhaps these might also be compelling applications. But for the moment, most people are kind of excited about this middle block. So where are we? Well, there's a number of different implementations that we could potentially build into one of these large scalable quantum computers involving ion traps, superconductors, linear optics, nitrogen vacancy centers, quantum dots, and the one that Microsoft is most interested in, Majorana zero modes, or topological quantum computing. And so where are we right now with these sorts of technologies? Well, we're in the baby steps. Really, the most kind of in terms of size and controllability, you know, you can arguably, there's a lot of argument about this number up here, but I put it down anyways. You can at least create a cat state of up to 14 qubits on using an ion trap. With superconductors, they've been catching up rapidly. You can get about 5 qubits. And despite that, one of the big advantages is we don't see any firm physical roadblocks that would prevent you scaling up to extremely large systems with this. Plenty of engineering problems, but in principle, this seems like the scalability will be a lot easier than building scalable ion traps. Now, the one, with Microsoft's interest is in Majorana zero modes, and one of the nobody's ever even seen one of these Majorana fermions, despite the recent claim in Nature that suggests evidence, or sorry, science shows evidence of these modes. But it turns out that what you get if one day these things are ever built, you end up actually getting some hardware error protection built into these. So you can expect that if this technology catches off, then your error correction that you'll need for these devices will be substantially lower. So really, you know, these are, from the perspective of Microsoft, kind of the most promising avenues that we see going forward to build these. But what's the key sort of thing that we're seeing here? Well, the key thing is that we're going to be pretty qubit limited, at least in the near future. So we really want to try to come up with algorithms that, first and foremost, require as few qubits as possible. Then, of course, we also need to keep down the number of operations because, well, the more operations you have in living in fault tolerance land, the more error correction you're going to need, the larger quantum system you're going to need, and it's going to start blowing up like crazy. So these are sort of the design specifications that you need. So this brings me around to arithmetic. Arithmetic is a key component for many of these algorithms. In particular, Shor's algorithm, many of the most important steps are essentially arithmetic operations. Similarly, in quantum simulation, we have, in general purpose quantum simulation at least, there's a quantum oracle that you have to be able to implement. And this quantum oracle often requires you to do arithmetic. You need to compute functions. So for this reason, this is extremely important. Also, something I'm going to be spending a lot of time talking about is linear systems algorithms, which were proposed by Harrow, Hassett, and Lloyd. And in order to, these basically solve systems of linear equations, but they need to perform a matrix inverse. And in order to do this, they need to calculate a reciprocal. So in order to compute, you know, 1 over x, you need to actually have some pretty complicated arithmetic built in. And the main question I'd like to address with this is, are the space requirements needed for existing approaches for doing this prohibitive? Or is this going to be a natural application? And so one of the key points is also, apart from space, I need to talk about how I'm going to emphasize my analysis of time in this work. Because obviously, you know, the time complexity depends on the gate set, and it depends on what you consider to be expensive. For the moment, we're really motivated by the analysis from the surface code, in which Clifford gates are cheap, i.e. transversal. Well, okay, phase gate is moderately expensive, but let's ignore that for the moment. The key point is that we're going to treat all Clifford gates, like C0 gates, Pauli gates, phase gates, as being essential. Oh, Hadamard as well, as being essentially free. And we're going to focus our attention on the non-Clifford gates, like T-gates and such. So how do we go about doing arithmetic conventionally right now in quantum algorithms? Well, there's a number of approaches. Mostly, we do arithmetic, or we do addition in the following form. We imagine we've got two registers, one storing a bit string representing x, another storing a bit string representing y. And what we do is we come up with fast quantum circuits for computing x plus y. In this case, typically the circuits that are used aren't directly just classical reversible circuits. There are these other circuits that have been proposed by Draper and others that actually use manifestly quantum operations to do a little bit better than what you could do if you just strictly stayed with reversible logic. But the key point is basically it's kind of conceptually exactly the same as what you would do on a classical computer. Yes? It's the time. It's time complexity that they end up improving. I forget exactly what the speed up exactly is compared to it, because it really depends on which adder you're comparing it to. But in any case, these adders can be trivially combined with shifts in order to provide multiplication. So your multiplication tends to look very similar. Except one of the things to note is that when you multiply like this, you can't do really an in-place multiplication. You have to store it in an additional register. And the reason why you can't do it in place is because all the operations that you do on a computer, a quantum computer, except for measurement, have to be unitary. So if you had zero over here, this process wouldn't be reversible. So that's why you have to store the result for multiplication and not addition in an additional register. So using this, we can end up doing things like reciprocals or other functions. And the way that you do this is you just decompose using numerical methods, division or whatever algorithm you want, into addition and multiplication. So essentially, these two operations, addition and multiplication, really that's the core of all the arithmetic that people have proposed so far for quantum computation. And now going back to the Harrow-Hasselman and Lloyd algorithm, just to give some intuition for how you would particularly use this, because this strongly motivates our particular approach, is what you want to do, again, as I said, you want to solve a linear system of equations, AX equals B. And X over here is what you'd like to find. And you can find that just by applying a matrix inverse on the vector B. So the way that you go about doing this is you use phase estimation in order to compute the eigenvalues of the operator A. Then if you know the eigenvalues of the operator A, then computing the inverse on that basis is really easy. You just divide all the eigenvectors through by their corresponding eigenvalue. So that's what you do. Then you transform back to the computational basis. The way that this is actually implemented in the Harrow-Hasselman-Lloyd algorithm is very similar, except there's an additional step, because dividing through by the amplitude, in the amplitude, isn't exactly quite straightforward to see how you would do that. The way that they do this is they compute this, they transform into the eigenbasis of the operator A and keep these the eigenvalues in an additional register. Then what they do is they perform a rotation, a Y rotation, a small rotation through an angle delta up here, divided by the eigenvalue. And if you measure this last qubit, then you can see for small rotations, then what you end up getting is you end up getting a factor of 1 over lambda multiplied through by everything. So that ends up dividing everything through by 1 over lambda if you post-select on measuring this last qubit to be 1. So that's the idea. Basically, for this algorithm, many of these other algorithms, we actually don't need to compute as a bit string the reciprocal. Really, the thing that we need is this reciprocal stored as a rotation angle. And this is one of the big motivations for our approach, because we directly go from the input to the rotation angle. We don't actually compute the reciprocal as a bit string. So again, you know, one of the things is if we did do this the conventional approach using ordinary arithmetic without skipping a step, as I said, you would need to have another bit string that stores 1 over x. So if you imagine you compute this, let's say you don't need very high precision, 16 bits of precision. Well, then you need 16 bits for the input. You need another 16 bits for that, at least. So we're looking at 32 bits minimal in order to store this, which can be kind of prohibitive. Now, how would you then go about actually computing this? Because you might need extra ancillas to go from, you know, the 16-bit input for x to the 16-bit input for like 1 over x. So Newton's method is a well-known method, and it's extremely time-efficient for doing this. So naturally, the question is, well, how space-efficient is it? Not very. It turns out, because of the fact that it's an iterative algorithm, what you have to do is you have to store all the information in order to reverse each of the iterative steps that you need in order to get that level of precision. It's because you have to be able to unwind the algorithm at every step in order to do it reversibly. So a naive reversible implementation of Newton's method over here, yeah, it requires 600 or so qubits in order to be able to do it. So what that means is you know, let's say what you want to do is you want to do a 100 qubit size Harrow-Hasselman-Lloyd linear systems algorithm, which is probably maybe a little excessive for what you would need to hit a crossover point, but certainly well beyond what you can do with a classical computer under most circumstances. Well, you need a grand total of about 725-ish qubits. And so the volume that you would actually be computing on is this, and this over here represents a total qubit volume. So you can see just by looking at this, this is incredibly wasteful. And you would really need to have a very large quantum computer to just be able to push through into this regime, roughly, where you expect a quantum computer to have a firm advantage over classical algorithms. So obviously, figuring out improved methods in, for space efficiency, for computing reciprocals and other functions, is an important goal if we'd like to be able to build a small quantum computer that can do computationally useful tasks like this. So again, what's our approach? As I alluded to previously, our approach is, rather than storing the numbers as bit strings, we store them as rotation angles. So imagine you've got a computation, you just got a single qubit. You want to keep a value x. You encode that then as a value between 0 and pi by 2. You can rescale everything logically however you like afterwards. But you keep it as a rotation angle, and then you can imagine doing operations as transformations of on the states. So for example, addition. Addition is really easy then from this perspective. If you want to add two rotation angles, well, all you have to do is do two rotations, one after another. So that seems pretty straightforward. Multiplication is way less than straightforward. Because what you have to do is you have to find some way of non-linearly transforming two input rotations, like this, into its product. And this is one of the things that stumped us for a while, figuring out a good way of doing this type of multiplication. And this is essentially the main result that I'd like you to walk away with, that this sort of a transformation is possible, and not just that, it can be it is essentially deterministic. Let me be a little bit more specific here. What I really mean is that you can perform arithmetic using a constant number of logical qubits. If you look at this on a physical level, obviously you're going to need to implement these logical qubits using an increasing number of physical qubits as your precision requirements get tighter and tighter. So there is still no free lunch when it comes to this. And if you're looking at your logical, your physical overhead, it's going to scale logarithmically when you consider the costs of error correction. But the key point here is that you're not wasting a precious logical qubit with this approach for something that essentially a classical bit could do. You're spending all of this time trying to correct the phase and all the rest of this information to these qubits. Why not use all those resources for this? Yes.
Well, I was just wondering about, like, what do you do about, like, the superposition? Like, are you allowing to, like, get two registers and then the superposition of the rotation angles?
Superposition becomes a lot more complicated. The reason why is because it turns out that these circuits over here, the success probability depends on the particular angles that you look at. So what ends up happening by performing the circuit, even though it'll succeed essentially every time when you do enough repetitions, the number of times that you need to repeat it will give you some indication about which of the branches you're in and partially collapse the state. So we have to do some voodoo in these cases, which makes the algorithm less efficient for superpositions, to flatten out the probability distribution and kind of blind the algorithm to which of the two branches it's in. It can be done, but it's a little more annoying. I'll talk about that at the end of the talk. But for the moment, I'm just going to be talking about the non-superposition case, because it's a lot simpler. So again, I'd like to just spend a quick moment, even though I touched on it earlier, talking about a cost model, again, emphasizing the fact that we're going to consider pi by 8, or T gates, as the cheap resource, or sorry, expensive resource, and C naught gates, like people often traditionally would consider to be an expensive resource, we consider cheap because of the fact they're cheap in these error-corrected codes. So now let's talk about the fundamental paradigm behind all of this that makes these things work, which is something that's been recently called the repeat until success circuit. And the idea behind this circuit is it's a measurement-based circuit. If many of you are familiar with the KLM circuit, it's very similar to that, in that what you have is you have a unitary transformation. It acts on your data qubit and some ancilla qubit up here. And this ancilla qubit kind of gives you the program. It tells what the transformation is supposed to do. Then what you do is you measure this ancilla register. And based on the measurement outcome, you decide one of two things. Are you going to output, because you got the correct answer, or are you going to repeat after performing a correction operation, the same thing? So circuits, repeat until success circuits always have this kind of decision theoretic form, where you perform a transformation, you do a measurement, and then you decide whether or not you succeeded or you need to correct the operation and try again. So for all of these cases, we one of the things we require is that a specific unitary correction is known a priori that can fix up the situation after a failure. The simplest case is where this correction operation is the identity gate. In some cases, you just don't need to do anything. You can just keep on throwing it at this gate over and over again until it succeeds. But in our case, we'll see that this correction operation is just a Clifford gate, so it's cheap from our in our framework. So the key thing about these circuits is that even though they're non-deterministic, you don't know in a particular run whether they'll succeed or fail. Because of the fact that when they fail to do what you intend them to do, they're always correctable, this circuit can always be repeated until you succeed. So in that sense, it's sort of deterministic, even though you don't know necessarily how many times you're going to have to run it before you get that deterministic output. So what are the elementary circuits that we use to do this? There's two circuits that make up the entirety of this. The first one is is known as the gearbox circuit. And we use this one for approximately squaring and doing a square multiply operation. And the second one is one known as the generalized programmable ancilla rotation, which is a generalization of the programmable ancilla rotation, which is a circuit that Cody Jones and others came up with in order to basically teleport rotations from one qubit to another. So we generalize it and make it do multiplication instead of just transferring a rotation. So let's talk first about the gearbox circuit, which is a circuit that I developed with Vadim Kaluchnikov, if you don't know him. He was a PhD student under Mike. So the idea behind this circuit really is the following. What we do is we have a whole bunch of ancillas up here. And we prepare these by applying whatever your favorite single qubit unitary. And then what you do is you perform a basically a controlled negative IX rotation. This essentially is like a multiply controlled Toffoli gate with a phase gate and a poly gate, I suppose, acting on the result. So you can directly implement this relatively cheaply at the cost of, well, an N Toffoli. Then what you do is you apply the inverse of that preparation and you measure. In the event that all of these measurements read zero, then what you end up doing is you end up essentially performing a rotation through an angle that is the products that is roughly the products of the squares of the off-diagonal matrix elements of these U's, which is cool. Because what this means is this allows you to take a whole bunch of relatively big rotations and transform that into a tiny, tiny, tiny rotation at an incredibly low cost, especially if you allow parallelism. The other thing that's even crazier is, all right, you might be thinking, well, you get all zeros, right? There's two to the D different outcomes over here. Getting all zeros sounds really improbable. Turns out it'll happen for small angles almost every single time. And furthermore, when you don't get all zeros, one of the neat things that comes out of the symmetry of this circuit is that every single time, no matter what you measure other than zero, you end up applying e to the negative I x pi by 4, which turns out to be a Clifford gate. So this means that you can always correct this circuit whenever it fails and try it again. I'm sorry? Okay, well, here's the reason why. It's because the success probability of success is sine to the fourth theta plus cos to the fourth theta, where theta is basically, it's like the product of all of these off-diagonal matrix elements. And let's imagine the case that just to get some intuition, the case where they're all small. So if all of these are very small, then the probability of success is going to essentially just be 1 over here, because theta is small. So if theta is small, then cosine to the fourth is about 1. So what that means is almost every single time, if you have relatively small inputs, you're going to end up getting a success. So it depends on what your input angles are, what the success probability is, but typically in these applications, it's going to be high. And even if it isn't high, then because failure isn't tragic, you can always correct and try again, then you can get by with a relatively small number of iterations usually. So All right, so what intuition can I provide you on a slide to give this? Well, unfortunately, without going through the math, I can't give you a complete intuition. But one of the things I'd like to say is that in order to understand basically what's going on, the key thing to note is that is this identity. E to the negative I theta x is cosine theta I minus I sine theta x. So essentially, what all this control logic is doing here is it's really enacting one of two things on this subspace. It's either doing I, or it's doing negative IX, right? And then essentially, by doing this control logic over here, this ends up making a different weight over the zero input and the all ones input, which ends up changing this effective angle that you end up getting in here and making it a function of what these input rotations are. I wish I could give you a good intuition for why the correction is always pi by 4, but it turns out to be a consequence of the math. Maybe there's some symmetry that other people see that I don't that leads to it. But in any case, that's basically it. It's because of this identity that this circuit doesn't just do nonsense. It always ends up leading to an X rotation. And so I know I'm belaboring this point, but I really wanted to make it really clear, because if you walk away with nothing else, having an idea of what the structure of these algorithms looks like is important. So really what we're doing is we apply this circuit if we want to square two inputs approximately, which is really what this would do if we had x and y input as rotation angles. We apply the circuit, and we have two outcomes. Either we measure all zeros or we don't. If we do measure all zeros, then we've approximately square multiplied the two inputs. If we haven't, then, well, we apply this. We correct it by doing the opposite rotation, and then we try the circuit again and just repeat this over and over again.
So the inputs that we're interested in come from the unitaries that we're applying?
Yeah, exactly. So for the particular case we're interested in here, they're just going to be single qubit rotations. So the idea is you get single qubit rotations that specify your input rotation angles, and you use the circuit to map that to output rotation angles. And the relationship for small rotation angles is approximately that if x and y are given as input, then this will output x squared times y squared. All right. So as I said before, yeah, this is basically how that'll work. If you have x and y as input on two different ancilla registers, you plug it through this circuit and wait till you succeed, you end up square multiplying the two. So this circuit is a square multiplier. And basically, it's found uses for floating point synthesis, which is a method for doing single qubit synthesis that can do small rotation angles at logarithmically exponentially less T depth than the existing circuit synthesis methods. So now let's talk about how we'd like to use this circuit and this strategy in order to implement not just rotations, but functions. So let's imagine what you have is you have some analytic function that you'd like to approximate. Every analytic function has a Taylor series. So we can imagine what we'd like to do is we have these circuits that do approximate squaring or multiplication and things like this. And the way we implement an arbitrary function is we take that Taylor series and come up with a sequence of these composed circuits that mimics the Taylor series of the function we'd like to do. And that's how we build it up. So one of the things is that the gearbox circuit over here, what it does is it square multiplies. So you can see that we could use this circuit in order to, given x as an input, implement x squared, or x to the fourth, or x to the eighth. But the problem is, how the heck do you end up using this circuit to do x cubed? Right? It turns out that there is a way we can use a gearbox circuit, but it turns out it's way too costly. So we need another component for doing this. And the component that we end up using is this generalized PAR circuit, which I, just to remind you of what it looks like, it should have been on that slide, but it's not. This is the generalized PAR circuit. So it looks really similar. The difference is that the measurement operation that we do on the right-hand side is totally different. Rather than doing the inverse of what we did of the state preparation, we do a GHZ measurement. And that GHZ measurement, it turns out, does an approximate multiplication rather than approximate square multiplication. But there's a big difference between the two. And that big difference is in this almost negligible to the eye from here, plus minus term in front. So there's two branches for this. The other one, it always did the correct rotation you wanted upon success. This guy over here, although it does the multiplication that we'd like to see, sometimes it'll give you the wrong sign. And that can be a real big problem, because you have to fix that somehow. Well, it depends on your framework. From the perspective of quantum error correction, the GHZ measurement is really straightforward because of the fact that it requires just a series of Clifford operations. So it's inexpensive in the framework that I'm talking about, but in many, like if you wanted to do this with scalable ion traps at a physical level, of course, this is going to be very, very, very expensive. But on the logical level, in error correction, it actually becomes easy. So it really just depends on sort of your problem. I do agree, though, that doing a 12-qubit GHZ measurement would be quite challenging. So what the problem with this generalized PAR circuit is that every single time we do it, we have a 50% chance of doing a forward or backwards rotation. So the strategy that this strategy also appeared in Cody Jones' original PAR circuits. And the idea basically is using this doubling down kind of gambler strategy for handling this. So if you fail to do your forward rotation, then you've done a backwards rotation. If you want to do the correct forwards rotation, then you say, well, I just double the rotation angle and try again. And you can keep on doing this over and over again, and eventually you'll succeed. This works great in their strategy. But one of the problems I said with these is that this is an approximate squarer. It's only a very accurate squarer when you're looking at a small rotation angle. So if you use this doubling down strategy, OK, maybe it's really accurate for the rotation angle you use at the top level. But now down here, if you failed once, you've doubled it. So it might not be terribly accurate here. Now you've quadrupled it, making it even less accurate. And at some point, everything just falls apart. So we can't use this tactic at all. So we needed something else. And this is what stumped us for a while. Because the next natural solution to this is to use amplitude amplification, in which we would say, OK, well, rather than just post-selecting and making, hoping that this happens, let's use amplitude amplification to make it happen. So the way that amplitude amplification works is it does a series of reflections about an initial state and a target state or ideal state that end up leading you to perform a rotation in the effective two-dimensional subspace spanned by the initial state and your target state. And by doing these reflections over and over again, it causes you to rotate up closer and closer to the target. So this is fantastic. But one of the big problems is that. Over there. We have to be able to reflect about the initial state. This is and if measurement is used at all in a non-trivial way in this process, then you can't really do that because you don't necessarily have a nice deterministic circuit that leads you back to the initial state. If you've measured, you've done something irreversible, and how do you get back past that measurement? So this is one of the problems with trying to use amplitude amplification. To be able to do it, at least in a naive way. You need to get around the fact that our circuits manifestly use measurement, and amplitude amplification cannot use measurement. Well, this problem was actually resolved by people here. So Barry Childs, Cleave, Kathari, and Soma came up with this technique known as oblivious amplitude amplification that works in a very, very special set of cases. And these are cases where your operator that you want to amplify on, upon success, if it performs a unitary operation, then you actually don't need to reflect about the initial state. And it turns out this is exactly the scenario we're looking at, because when success occurs, you do a single qubit rotation. And that single qubit rotation is unitary. So we can apply this theorem directly in order to be able to apply amplitude amplification and completely eliminate the possibility of failure, which is really kind of awesome. So basically, for this, as I said before, the probability of success of doing a forwards of rotation or a backwards rotation is 50-50. You don't know, given that you get a success, whether or not you've done the forward or backwards branch. But it's heralded by one of the qubits. So you can read that qubit and figure out whether you got forward or backwards. So in order to get this scheme to work, it turns out that 1/2 is the worst probability for amplitude amplification. Because 1/2 just maps to 1/2 when you apply amplitude amplification. So we need to do something that seems really stupid in order to make this work. What we do is we say, OK, we define success to be doing a rotation in the proper direction and also flipping a coin and getting heads. That sounds retarded because, you know, you are doing a, purposefully lowering your success probability to no good ends. But there is a good end because 1/4 is awesome success probability for amplitude amplification. It will give you, it'll work every single time after doing one iteration. So we use this trick. We poison our success probability in order to make sure that we will always get 100% success after doing a single iteration of amplitude amplification. So that's how we get around this problem. So basically, again, the two key points that I'd like you to take home from the early part of this is that we have these repeat until success circuits that can do approximate square multiply, and we can use oblivious amplitude amplification and this generalized programmable ancilla rotation to do approximate multiplication. You might wonder, well, if I've got approximate multiplication, why bother with approximate square multiplication? It turns out that because we don't have to do amplitude amplification on the top case, it's a little cheaper. That's why we keep two rather than one paradigm behind behind our approach. So again, you know, we're going to be building up the Taylor series. So one of the things that we'd like to do is we'd like to come up with a method for building these circuits to arbitrarily high order. As I said, these circuits are only valid to leading order. So let's say you wanted to build a multiplier out of this. If I just use the generalized PAR circuit, then what it'll do is it'll do this operation. It'll do x, y, and then some correction term that looks like this. It's some constant times x cubed y plus y cubed x. So if we want to come up with an even better multiplier, then there's actually a really natural approach that you take. What you do is you add even more multiplications or even more circuits that look like this that don't affect the leading order term but will counteract these higher order error terms. And you can build up recursively higher and higher order approximate circuits that get better and better as you go forward. And how do these circuits actually work? Well, the way they work is something like this. Imagine what you want to do is we want to do phi 1 squared times phi 2 is our rotation angle. We can combine these circuits together recursively in order to create a cubic term, like that, like one of these cubic terms in the previous slide. So the way that you would do this is you begin with this, which is the gearbox circuit. So that's the inner argument here. And then that prepares a state, which then is one of the two arguments of the programmable ancilla rotation multiplier circuit here. So this is the PAR circuit, and the gearbox circuit at the top provides one of the two inputs to that. So that's how we recurse these ideas together in order to be able to perform cubic operations or higher order terms. And this circuit, by doing two of them, we can counteract those two terms that you saw in the previous error. So these are particular optimized circuits that I've come up with for this in order to minimize the number of applications of oblivious amplitude amplification that you need. So by following this strategy in order to kill these error terms off in the Taylor series order by order, you end up with these sorts of things. And one of the things that you notice is that, let's say your goal is to build a squaring circuit out of this. I could have picked any function, but I just picked squaring for the sake of illustration. If I just use the gearbox circuit over here, which is, the PAR circuit is what I used here to do this, it's a fourth order formula, and the error for small inputs is actually really good. For small inputs, it's 10 to the minus 9, so it's essentially, you know, nearly perfect multiplication. But as we start looking at values near 1, then the error is about 20%. So the circuits start performing quite poorly for big rotation angles. Going to higher order fixes that, at least at first. We end up seeing much smaller errors by going to the next higher order formula, pretty much across the board. But as we go to one order higher, maybe I could have come up with a better formula for this, but for big angles, the errors actually get worse than the middle formula. And this is common for series approximations. Sometimes as you go to higher and higher order, you don't necessarily expect for large inputs for the series to converge. So what this says is this says, well, okay, this is all nice and everything. If you want to get arbitrarily small error, it might look like you can increase the order of the Taylor series as high as you want in order to reduce the error. But in practice, something else is going to be needed. Yeah? Sure. If you expand about 1, then everything works beautifully for here. Then again, it won't work for values near 0. So it really depends on what your dynamic range actually is of the values. So in practice, if you have some advice beforehand about what range of x and y you're going to need, you expand about the midpoint, and you know that'll often do the trick. So this trick is actually even being used here with these pi by 4 subtractions. So yes, it's a very good idea. All right, so something else is going to be needed, and that idea is time slicing. And the idea of time slicing is this. These rotations work very well for small inputs. So the idea is by slicing everything up into smaller and smaller rotations, we can get arbitrarily better approximations by simply just decreasing the effective size of the rotations that we're doing. So for example, you know, let's say that we were looking at doing a rotation of 1. All right. Well, one of the things that we could do is we could use a whole bunch of rotations at this size, glue them together, and then their error collectively will be much smaller than this 20% that we would get if we just tried to do it in one step. So to give you a better idea of how this works, imagine what we wanted to do is we wanted to multiply x times y. Well, one of the things that we can do is we could say, all right, well, x times y is the same thing as multiplying x over r times y over r times r squared. So that's what we do. We break up our big multiplication into r squared smaller multiplications and then add them together. And so this is the one application of the triangle inequality. If you end up using this, and for just, say, the lowest order formulas we have, the gearbox circuit, what we end up seeing is the error scales like 1 over r to the fourth. There's r squared steps. So the error after r squared of them is 1 over r squared. So by increasing r, you can make the total error as small as you want. So again, this kind of, you know, simplistically, if we wanted to do this in 4 steps, this is what it would be. Rather than doing it in 1, we break up this rotation into a series of 4, like that. All right.
So yeah.
You see, this is a very good point, because something I'd like to get to with this. Because one of the awesome things about doing reversible circuit synthesis is that the time complexity scales polylogarithmically with the number of bits of precision you need. This isn't true here at all. Here, it scales polynomially with the error tolerance you want to hit. So really, what we're doing is there are some space-time trade-offs here. We're very good in terms of the number of logical qubits you need. We can get by with a constant number. But our time complexity isn't nearly as good as what you could get away with if you're willing to pay all 625 of those qubits to be able to do it. So this by no means replaces reversible computation, but it gives you an alternative. No. It's something kind of, that's not quite kind of the point. Point here, basically, is that if you're taking a look at, it's all a question of what your problem is. For many problems, you have a fixed number of digits of precision, like quantum simulation problems, for example. It doesn't make any sense to simulate a molecule's energy levels below, say, the threshold of chemical accuracy, which is the best that you can get under thermal fluctuations at standard temperature and pressure. So often, many of these problems have a hard, physical, fixed limitation on the amount of accuracy that you need for the problem. So for those cases, looking at the scaling with the accuracy isn't as important as it might be in other applications. So in applications where you need exceedingly high precision, then yeah, sure, this throws everything away. But Grover search isn't necessarily it's not even directly related. So all right. Let's take a look at the number of rotations that you end up needing to do this rotation up here, which is a relatively big rotation as far as it goes. By slicing enough times, you can hit, obviously, any error threshold you want. And one of the things that we end up seeing with this that's really kind of, you know, it's interesting, is that there are trade-offs and crossovers between these different algorithms. The basic formula, at first, it's the best that you can out of all of them. But once you start looking, wanting to see error of 10 to the minus 5 or less, then these other formulas start becoming much better. First, the sixth order formula is the best formula we have. And then a crossover point ends up happening with the eighth order formula, and then that becomes better. as you start going to higher and higher order paths at this point, you expect more and more crossings to occur later and later. So this basically is just really what I want to emphasize with this is that you can hit any error tolerance you want with these rotations. It's just a question of how much work you want to do in order to hit that. Okay? And now let's compare this to classical methods for doing for multiplication. All right? So the standard methods that we, by classical methods, really what I mean is I mean taking a look at methods from classical reversible synthesis and applying those to do multiplication and comparing it to the same cost of what would be required for ours. So for doing the fourth order multiplication formula, we only need 3 qubits. Actually, you'll notice it jumps from 3 to 4 at this point. It's because at some point we need oblivious amplitude amplification in order to make the time slicing work. That's why you see this one jump. There's not going to be any other jumps. It's going to be 4 qubits for all time after that. So this is the number of T gates that we end up needing. We always need just 4 for this. If we look at the sixth order, then we need at most 5 qubits to do the same thing. And the number of T gates for going from 4 to 6 can be substantially lower if you need 16 bits of precision or something comparable. For 2 bits of precision, M4 seems to be actually the best out of all the methods that we've tested, even in terms of the T gates. One of the things, the carry ripple, is basically just uses the carry ripple adder and shifts in order to do it. And it requires essentially twice as many qubits as the inputs. So this ends up increasing linearly with the number of bits of precision that you need. Whereas the number of qubits that you require for these methods to implement the desired rotation is constant. Now, of course, this might not be a fairest comparison because there's also another classical algorithm that also is constant in number of qubits, which is table lookup. You could essentially just program your function as a series of like Toffoli gates and get it to just rigidly, you know, go through the truth table and output exactly what the bit string output should be. And you know, actually, in terms of qubits, that's even better than ours. That only requires 2 ancilla qubits on top of the input. But the big problem is the number of T gates ends up blowing up like crazy as you start going up to larger things. So this means that our method looks like it's it's a nice trade-off between the time and space complexities of table lookup and the carry ripple multiply. So I'm running a bit low on time. Reciprocals also, we also investigate reciprocals using a very similar strategy. So there are 3 approaches that we end up considering. We end up considering implementing rotations, reciprocals using a binomial method, otherwise known as the IBM method for computing reciprocals. And then this leads to a certain polynomial that needs to be evaluated, and we evaluate that polynomial using our circuits. An even simpler approach that we take is we just approximate the reciprocal with the Chebyshev polynomial and implement that polynomial. And a final crazy method that I really enjoy is we directly implement this using as a sum of square waves. And I'll get to that later. So anyways, reciprocal calculation, the way it works is using a binomial method. This is a really cool approximation. I love it, by the way. The way that it works is what you do is you rescale your reciprocal. You basically take the value that you want to compute the reciprocal of, and you round that up to the next power of 2. Then you can consider the reciprocal as this 1 over the next power of 2 times this other factor, which is at most 2. So then all the work, since this can be computed really easily, all the work essentially boils down to evaluating that. This over here, you can write this out using a binomial expansion as this, which is equivalent to that, which is equivalent to that. And you notice a trend as you keep on doing this. You always will multiply the numerator by the previous 1 plus the previous denominator with a minus switch to a plus. But the next denominator will end up increasing quadratically. So the next one after this will be 1 minus x to the 16th and so on and so forth. At some point, for small enough x, you can just say, all right, you know, 1 half to the 128th power is 0. And you completely forget about the denominator and then just evaluate this polynomial at the top. And wow, wouldn't you know it, polynomials are exactly what our circuits can implement. So that's the idea. We reduce the problem of computing this to a problem of evaluating a polynomial. We stick it into our gearbox circuit. And this is the complexity. A of doing it. It requires a logarithmic, at most a logarithmic number of additional qubits to be able to do it using this method, which is fantastic, because the best methods otherwise use a linear number of qubits. So the next approach is a Chebyshev approximation. I won't spend too long on it. It uses just a Chebyshev polynomial approximation to this factor in here rather than using a binomial method. And it's great because of the fact that it minimizes the error in the approximation uniformly over the interval. So here are some Chebyshev approximations, and I call these R2 to R6, which implement this 1 over 1 minus x. Here I called it y instead of x, but whatever. So just to put this into comparison, for simplicity, I've only looked at the lowest order Chebyshev polynomial and compared it to other formulas here. So one of the things that's interesting is that Euclid's algorithm, at least for small inputs, we do a lot better with the Chebyshev approximation. We end up requiring only 6 qubits, no matter what. We can't, with the fixed Chebyshev approximation, hit arbitrary precision, because you need to increase the order of your Chebyshev polynomial in order to hit arbitrary precision. Here, I've only looked at a fixed order. So that's why it's not applicable for the higher accuracies. But something really kind of neat happens here that's worth mentioning. One of the things that's very interesting is table lookup actually isn't all that expensive in this particular case. The reason why is because the dimension of the space that you're doing a lookup in is quadratically smaller. So for that reason, you actually table lookup isn't that bad. It requires a relatively small number of T gates and virtually no qubits. So one of the things that that this suggests is, looking forward, when people are suggesting Harrow, Hassett, and Lloyd, depending on the level of precision they need, the actually table lookup might be an incredibly qubit efficient way of them doing these reciprocals, while incurring a number of T gates that's subdominant to the cost of the simulation algorithm. So now let's get on to square wave synthesis, which is really wild. And the basic idea behind this is that I've only talked about what the gearbox circuit does for small inputs. Question is, what does it do for bigger inputs? And the answer is something kind of neat. So let's say I start out with the basic gearbox circuit. And this is an input for the rotation angle x, and I'm only considering one input for it. So what this should do for small inputs is approximately square x. But for bigger inputs, it creates this kind of, you know, bell curve looking shape. But what happens if I recurse it and feed it into itself? Well, then it turns into this green curve. Then it turns into this red curve. And actually, you can prove, as you increase the iteration order or over and over again, that it ends up approaching a square wave in the number rapidly, as the, doubly exponentially, in fact, in the limit as the number of iterations increases. Yeah. No, the width stays constant. And the reason why is because at pi by 4 over here, it has to have a fixed point, because the circuit's a Clifford circuit. So it has to map Clifford's to Clifford's. So for that reason, this width is constant as the iteration order increases. So that's basically it. And the idea behind square wave synthesis is, if you've got this method for generating square waves, then you can do the same thing that a AWG does to generate an arbitrary function. What you do is you just approximate that as a train of square waves at different frequencies. You sum a bunch of them together, and you can implement any function you feel like, even a reciprocal, using this without even going directly to this these other ideas. And so we've done that. These are the errors. They, for the most basic approach, we end up seeing errors that are about on the order of, oh gosh, 2% in the absolute worst possible cases for figuring out reciprocals ranging from 1 to 71. And these are errors after everything. But most of the errors tend to be roughly around about half a percent. And this can be improved by increasing the number of waves that you use and increasing the order of the waves, making them closer to the ideal square wave that you want. So this is really kind of neat. And the reason why, kind of broader, that I think this is interesting is it shows that actually there's this similarity between doing arithmetic on a quantum computer to analog function generation that you would more commonly see in a lab. So the interesting thing is, by using measurement and this analog nature of quantum information processing instead of the digital, you end up seeing something that actually kind of feels, in cases, more hybrid. It feels closer to some of the analog signal processing stuff that people have been doing for years. So Now, let's get back to Dave's question and what little time remains. So, entangled inputs. As I said, entangled inputs totally throw all of this off. And the reason why, again, is because of the fact that the success probability depends on what the inputs are. So if you perform, try to perform a rotation that's controlled by a qubit that's in a superposition, then the probability of success given input one is not equal to the probability of success given input two. So every time you fail the circuit at the circuit, you gain some evidence that the state is either x1 or x2. And because information comes at the price of disturbance, this is no longer truly a repeat until success circuit in this case. Yeah. It still is true, but we have to be clear about what the probability of success is, because what I'm using here for the probability of success is forward versus backwards rotation. And in that case, because I'm just amplifying on that, then it's always 50-50 regardless of what the inputs are. So it's not problematic here. If I was trying to amplify on getting success at this level, then you're right, it wouldn't work here. But because it's just being used for forward versus backwards rotation, it's fine. So how do we end up getting around this? The way we get around this, basically, is that say we wanted to implement the gearbox circuit as our primitive. Well, what we do now is we add two more irrelevant gearbox circuits. So we add this gearbox circuit up here and this other gearbox circuit that ideally, upon success, should implement the opposite rotation to this one. Then what we end up doing is we end up going through this, and we see that upon success, it'll give you the exact same output, but this ends up changing the failure probability. The failure probability ends up giving you this over here. It's a leading order. So you end up getting a quarter. Now, at this point, we can use oblivious amplitude amplification approximately, because within errors that are negligible, all of these will have success probability 1/4. So we can amplify on that and succeed. So that's how we end up getting around this and quadratically reducing the probability of failure, the information leakage, and this by slicing it repeatedly can be made arbitrarily small. So to conclude, basically the main thing is Martin and I give a new way of thinking about doing arithmetic on quantum computers. It has some time-space trade-offs. It requires a constant number of logical qubits in order to hit arbitrary precision. But it can require, in certain cases, more T gates than the classical reversible synthesis methods. So this approach could be quite useful for implementing certain functions, like the functions used in Harrow-Hastedham and Lloyd. Of course, also table lookup seems to be pretty good, too, there. But the point is that this method is very, very, very qubit efficient, but perhaps not so space efficient. Time efficient. But more broadly speaking, one of the things that I think this work really points towards is that we haven't been thinking about numerical analysis right in quantum computing. We've been thinking about numerical analysis in quantum computing as a subset of classical computing. We haven't been considering the fact that really we have a completely different toolbox, completely different set of things that we can play with. We can, for example, use measurement here as an active participant in order to do computations, whereas this doesn't make any sense from the perspective of classical computing. And these additional freedoms really suggest that we need to be spending more time thinking about how we actually compute and what our objectives are in quantum computation, because this could very well lead to an entirely new field of numerical analysis and new ways of understanding computation. Thank you very much.